Hi. Let's try to understand a small topic, the measurement of blood pressure. Clinically, very important topic. And the measurement of blood pressure it needs to be accurate so as to label the hypertension, and the treatment of hypertension is solely based on how accurately you measure the blood pressure. But measuring the blood pressure by sphygmomanometry has lots of fallacies or lots of chances for error, and the method itself needs to be understood first in order to understand the most accurate way of denoting the blood pressure. So let's see some of those fallacies in the measurement of blood pressure by sphygmomanometry. What is the principle of this sphygmomanometry? The principle is that we apply a BP cuff to the arm, the Rivaroki cuff to the arm, and we raise the pressure in the cuff. Let's say this is the brachial artery and the cuff is applied to the arm. We raise the pressure in the cuff, and the principle for sphygmomanometry is balancing of pressure between the cuff and the brachial artery. What I mean here is, let's assume that the BP is 100 mm of Hg as measured by intravascular measurement. I mean, imagine that a catheter was placed in the artery and that catheter was connected to the manometer. So we are directly measuring the pressure from inside the vessel. Let's say that pressure is 100 mm of Hg. And now we are measuring it with sphygmomanometer, the Rivaroki cuff. So the principle is something like this. We apply the BP cuff, we raise the pressure in the BP cuff, and when the pressure just outside the artery will be 100, the artery will be occluded. 100 and anywhere above 100, the artery will remain occluded. And when the pressure just outside the artery, brachial artery, falls just below 100, the artery will open up. So imagine we have raised the pressure in the cuff, and artery was completely occluded, and then we start lowering it. When the pressure just outside the artery will be just less than 100, the artery will open up for the first time, and the blood flow will start, restart rather. It was occluded for some time. So that's the principle of the sphygmomanometry. Now let us see what all things they can go wrong, or they need to be understood clearly regarding this method. Let's start with the palpatory method. The palpatory method, as we all are aware, it measures only the systolic blood pressure. Let's say with each systole, pressure rises to, let's take some figures as 120 mm of Hg. And therefore, having taken the systolic pressure as 120 mm of Hg, with each systole, the pulse comes to the periphery and we feel it on the radial artery. Pulse is felt at the radial, at the wrist, on the radial artery. Now consider this, we raise the pressure in the cuff up to, let's say, 150 mm of Hg, and we start lowering it. The artery is occluded, there is no pulse right now. Now we are starting to lower the cuff pressure. Cuff pressure 150, 140, 130, 120. What happens? For the first time now, after the occlusion, the first time, the vessel will open up with each systole and the pulse will reappear. The blood flow and the pulse had stopped because your cuff pressure was 150 or 140 or 130. As soon as it reached 120, now the cuff pressure will not be able to occlude the artery, and therefore artery will open up, there will be pulse, there will be blood flow. The moment you feel the pulse at the wrist, you look at the mercury manometer. That was the pressure which is same as the systolic pressure, because at that point cuff pressure was equal to the systolic pressure, and just below that the artery opened up, we felt the pulse for the first time. But what's the problem? It is going to underestimate the systolic pressure. Look, first of all, it does not measure the diastolic pressure, because pulse is going to come. Pulse is the indicator in the palpatory method, and pulse comes only with the systole. So we have only a systolic indicator, and therefore we will know only the systolic pressure. Now, what is the reason for underestimation, slight underestimation? Look, we have applied the cuff to the arm, and we are feeling the pulse at the wrist. So imagine this, the cuff pressure reached 120 mm of Hg, that is the systolic pressure in the brachial artery. The artery opens up and the pulse reappears for the first time, but the pulse will take some time to come from brachial artery to the radial artery. We are feeling the pulse at the wrist, so it will take some time for the pulse to reach the wrist. And imagine that we are measuring the blood pressure. While measuring the blood pressure, we are lowering the mercury manometer, the mercury, continuously. So the moment cuff pressure reached, cuff pressure reaches the systolic pressure, the artery opened up and the pulse came to the wrist. But it took some time for the pulse to go from brachial artery to the radial artery to the wrist. It's a very minor time, it's in milliseconds, fraction of a millisecond, but still there is some time lapse for the pulse to travel from brachial artery to the radial artery, and by that time your mercury has gone down little, because we were continuously lowering the mercury in the manometer. So the moment you feel the pulse at the wrist, you look at the mercury manometer and say, hey, this is the systolic blood pressure. But actually, cuff pressure had reached the systolic pressure just before that, and it took some time for the pulse to travel to the wrist, and then you felt it. And by that time, the mercury manometer has slightly gone down. So it is likely to underestimate the systolic blood pressure because of that time lapse for the pulse to travel from brachial artery to the radial artery. So that's one fallacy, let's say, in the measurement of blood pressure by sphygmomanometry. Now let's come to the, let's not call it fallacy, let's try to understand, let's say, various dimensions of the sphygmomanometry and how it compares with the actual blood pressure. Look, we are all the time, I'm emphasizing that compared to the actual intravascular pressure as measured by a catheter placed in the artery and the catheter connected to a manometer. So compared to that measurement, how this measurement stands? First, the palpatory method, and we know this is slightly underestimation of the systolic pressure. Now coming to the auscultatory method. What can be the problem with the auscultatory method? I need to make 2-3 points in this. First is, the sphygmomanometry tends to overestimate, or rather it will give you a higher pressure as compared to the actual intravascular pressure measured by the manometer, direct catheter and connected to the manometer. That gave you, let's say, when you placed the catheter and measured the pressure, and let's say it was 100 mm of Hg, the directly measured intravascular pressure, let's say it is 100 mm of Hg. And as we have said, that the point which we take is that just start opening up of the artery, and the principle is balancing of pressure between the cuff and the artery. So we raise the pressure in the cuff, and start lowering it. Now, the moment pressure just outside the artery becomes 100, the artery opens up. That's our basic assumption, that's our basic premise for this method. But we have applied cuff to the arm, and means externally, and cuff pressure is reaching the artery which is located deep within, and between the cuff and the artery there is a tissue, and there is something called as a tissue pressure. So what's going to happen is some of the cuff pressure is dissipated as it reaches the artery. Can you consider this? Can you imagine this? That we are saying that artery will be just occluded if the pressure just outside the artery is 100, and anywhere above 100 artery will remain occluded, and pressure just outside the artery becomes less than 100, artery opens up and we feel the sounds or we feel the pulse. But for the pressure just outside the artery to be 100, pressure over here to be 100, pressure in the cuff might have to be about 105 or 106 mm of Hg, because 6 mm of Hg of the cuff pressure will be dissipated in the intervening tissue. Cuff is on the outside, artery is deep within, so some of the cuff pressure is likely to be dissipated in the intervening tissue. So we are just taking arbitrary figures. If the cuff pressure is 106, then the pressure that reaches just outside the artery will be 100, and it will be just occluding the artery. Look, we are looking at that point where artery was just occluded, or artery was just, it just opened up for the first time and you feel the pulse or you feel the Korotkov sounds. So that point which you look at in the mercury manometer is 106 when the artery opened up for the first time. But actually the arterial pressure was 100, because the 6 mm of Hg of the cuff pressure was dissipated, lost in the intervening tissue. And only 100 reaches the artery and occludes the artery, or just less than that and the artery opens up. 99 and the artery opens up and the first pulse is felt. So, sphygmomanometry generally gives you higher pressure as compared to directly measured actual intravascular pressure placed, catheter placed in the artery and connected to the manometer. This is one way of thinking, one direction of thinking. There are other proponents which propose exactly the opposite. They say that supposing that tissue has a pressure of 6 mm of Hg, then that means that 6 mm of Hg is already being exerted on the artery. So if your cuff pressure is 94 plus 6, 100, that 100 will reach the artery and will just occlude the artery. See, the point is what pressure is reaching just outside the artery. Now, the proponents of this theory say that 6 mm of Hg is being exerted by the tissues on this artery. So even if your cuff pressure is 94 plus 6, 100 will reach the artery and will just occlude the artery. So when the arterial pressure is 100, actually your cuff pressure is giving you 94 when the artery just opens up or just occluded. This is not an acceptable theory, because tissues do not exert the pressure on the arteries. Tissues are generally exerting the pressures on the capillaries. So it cannot be taken as a correct argument. Tissue has a certain layer between the artery and the cuff. That's the correct explanation. So basically what we are saying is dissipation of the cuff pressure is what gives us higher pressure by sphygmomanometry as compared to the directly measured intravascular pressure. looking further, going one step beyond, whether auscultatory method, and just let me add one more point here. What would happen if there is obesity? If there is obesity, by sphygmomanometry, we would get even higher pressure, because obesity means more tissue. Look, between cuff and the artery, there is muscle, there is fat. In obesity, there would be more tissue, and that means more dissipation of cuff pressure in the tissue. And therefore, your cuff pressure will have to be 108 or 109. Because 9 mm of Hg will get dissipated in the intervening, I'm talking about obesity. In obesity, more dissipation of pressure will occur because tissue is greater in bulk. And therefore, you will need even more pressure in the cuff to occlude the artery, just about occlude the artery. So in obesity, even higher pressure will be recorded by sphygmomanometry as compared to the directly measured intravascular pressure. Well, we consider, while don't get confused here, because the pressures that we normally record, we are always talking about the sphygmomanometry, and therefore it's not high or low. We are just, when I say high or low, it is just comparison between intravascular pressure directly measured compared to the sphygmomanometry. So actually there is no error, because we have all the data that we have, all that data is of sphygmomanometry. So it's not an error, mind you. It's just that I am saying comparing the two types of pressures. Okay, so obesity will give you even higher pressure because of a more tissue. Higher pressure compared to directly measured intravascular pressure. Remember, I am emphasizing it again, when we say hypertension, when we say normotension, we say hypotensive, all those pressures basically are from the sphygmomanometry only. So it's not as if there is some kind of an error that is coming with this Rivaroki curve or sphygmomanometry. Right. Now next, one more thing is what happens with the auscultatory method with the Korotkov sounds. Let's look at that. Now Korotkov sounds means we apply stethoscope over the brachial artery. We place stethoscope over the brachial artery beyond the cuff, and we get the sounds. So imagine this, that the blood pressure in this vessel is 120 by 80. Before I tell you anything about this, let me say there are two types of blood flow. The laminar flow, which is silent, it does not produce any sounds, and the turbulent flow, which produces sounds which can be heard through stethoscope. So when you hear Korotkov sounds, it means the blood flow is turbulent. That's why you can hear the sounds, the Korotkov sounds. Let that be clear in the beginning. Now, let's say, let's keep aside all that dissipation of cuff pressure and palpatory method and so on and so forth. Let's just right now concentrate that we have a pressure of 120 by 80. We raise the cuff pressure up to 150 and we start lowering it. What happens is, as soon as the pressure reaches 120, I'm ignoring that dissipation of cuff pressure and all that theory. Right now we are just concentrating on the Korotkov sounds. So when the cuff pressure reaches 120, now for the first time the artery will open up and the blood starts flowing. Your cuff pressure is 120. So you get the first sound, the first phase of the Korotkov sounds. The tapping sounds will begin to appear. Then you are lowering the cuff. What happens is your cuff pressure is, let's say, 115, 110. That means your cuff pressure is less than the systolic pressure of the artery, but more than the diastolic pressure of the artery. 115, 110, 105. So what happens is, with each systole, the artery opens up and there is a flow to the periphery, through the brachial artery. And because this flow is turbulent, look, we had, this is a narrowed vessel and the blood is now spurting through this narrowed vessel. So there is a turbulence in the blood flow and that produces the sound. We call it Korotkov sounds. So first phase, Korotkov sounds are loud tapping sound. Then the second phase, there are murmurish sounds. Then again, third phase will be a loud tap. The point is, in these first three phases, the sounds were, there was sound, then gap, then sound, then gap. Why there was gap? Because diastolic pressure is 80 and your cuff pressure is still more than that. And therefore, what was happening was with each systole, the artery opened up. Systolic pressure is 120 in the artery, so artery opened up and there is a flow, but that flow is with turbulence because artery was narrowed and we get the sound. But with diastole, your cuff pressure is still higher, it's more than the diastolic pressure of the vessel. So artery closes down, there is no sound. First three phases are like that, sounds, tuck, gap, tuck, gap, tuck, gap. That gap is when the artery has a diastolic pressure. Finally, fourth phase of the Korotkov sound is muffling of the sound. Now, muffling of the sound means now the sound becomes continuous. Sound becoming continuous means there is now sound during diastole also. It's a muffled sound, a continuous sound. Sound during diastole. Why there is sound during diastole? Remember, first three phases were sound, then no sound, gap. Because your cuff pressure was more than the diastolic blood pressure and therefore artery was closed down during diastole. Then again, next systole, artery opens up, there is sound again. But muffling means a continuous sound, means now there is a sound during systole as well as diastole. Why there is sound during diastole also now? Because there is flow during diastole has begun. That means your cuff pressure has reached the diastolic pressure in the vessel, in the artery. So, there is a continuous sound, sound during diastole as well. That's the muffling of the sound. And then finally, fifth phase is disappearance of the sound. Why the sound disappears? That's because the blood flow which was turbulent now becomes laminar again. That's why the sound disappears. So, disappearance. Look, normally we take disappearance of sound as the diastolic blood pressure. Why? Because that is more universally reproducible. We can't make out the muffling of the sound. But everybody can figure out the disappearance of the sound. That point is taken as the diastolic blood pressure because it is universally reproducible, easily reproducible. That's the point. But actually, the fourth phase of the Korotkov sounds, that the muffling of the sounds, corresponds more accurately with the diastolic pressure, because muffling means a continuous sound, that means sound during systole as well as diastole. Why there is a sound during diastole? Because now the flow is also there during diastole. That means your cuff pressure is not able to occlude the artery during diastole also. That means your cuff pressure is lower than the diastolic pressure. So when the sound muffled, that should be taken as the diastolic pressure, and then sound disappears. That means flow became laminar once again. But as I said, disappearance is taken universally. It tends to, normally there is a gap of only about 5 mm of Hg or so between muffling of sound and disappearance of sound. So not much of a difference. But if there are conditions of high turbulence, imagine there is a condition of high turbulence, severe exercise or any such condition which produces high velocity of the blood flow and high turbulence, then the difference between muffling and disappearance may be as high as 20, 30, 40 mm of Hg. And if you are taking disappearance of the sound as the diastolic pressure, your diastolic pressure is likely to be underestimated. Because as I said, actually it's the muffling that corresponds more accurately with the diastolic blood pressure. So, because of the high turbulence in the blood, between muffling and disappearance, when the blood flow becomes laminar, that's the disappearance. There was, because of the high turbulence, there is a gap of 20-30 mm of Hg between muffling and disappearance. High turbulence, therefore sounds were there. And then they disappeared. So that's another way of looking at things, and that can produce sometimes errors, especially in certain conditions. So that's about the various aspects, various dimensions of measurement of BP by sphygmomanometry. One potential source of error is silent gap or auscultatory gap. What is the silent gap or auscultatory gap in the Korotkov sounds? Imagine a person's BP is 200 by 100. What should happen is you raise the BP cuff up to 220 and you start lowering it. So first sound should appear at 200 and sound should muffle or disappear by 100. You take 200 by 100. These are the arbitrary figures, just to explain. You take the blood pressure as 200 by 100, systolic and diastolic. And now again, I'm keeping aside all those theories that we have discussed so far. Sound should start at 200, Korotkov sound should continue, and the sounds will disappear at 100. You take the BP as 200 by 100. Now, in some people, there is a so-called silent gap or auscultatory gap. That is, supposing this person has silent gap, what happens is, at 200, the first sound appears. Then suddenly the sound disappears at 170. It reappears at 140 and finally disappears at 100. So there is a gap between 170 and 140. The sounds disappeared. There were no sounds. And therefore, this gap is called as silent gap or auscultatory gap. First of all, what is the reason for this silent gap or auscultatory gap? The reason is not clearly known. But what could be hypothesized is that during this phase, sounds disappeared. Flow was there, but sounds disappeared means the Reynolds number is a number that determines or that indicates whether the blood flow will be turbulent or laminar. Reynolds number more than 3000, the blood flow is turbulent. Reynolds number less than 2000, the blood flow is laminar. And it's determined by the velocity of the blood flow and diameter of the vessel. So Reynolds number going less, becoming less, and therefore sound disappearing. That's one hypothesis. So there is less turbulence of in the blood flow, therefore sounds were not there and then they again reappeared. That's the possible explanation for silent gap, that the Reynolds number fell below a critical level and then again it rose, again it increased. Now what could be the error? Supposing you were not aware of the silent gap in this individual and you are checking the blood pressure for the first time, and you raise the pressure up to, let's say, 150 mm of Hg only. The cuff pressure is raised up to 150 mm of Hg and start lowering from that point only. That means you are in this person's silent gap. And as you start lowering the cuff pressure, your first sound will appear at 140 mm of Hg and sound will disappear at 100. That means you will take his blood pressure as 140 by 100. Actually, it is 200 by 100. So, in the silent gap, what is the error in the estimation of or measurement of blood pressure is low systolic and normal diastolic. And therefore, remember, that's the importance of palpatory method. Therefore, always, always first measure the blood pressure by palpatory method. It will clearly or at least roughly give you the idea about the systolic blood pressure, palpatory method, so that then such errors can be avoided. Remember, therefore, how to avoid silent gap? Always measure first with the palpatory method. It tells you the systolic blood pressure correctly, and then you proceed to the auscultatory method for measurement of blood pressure. So these are some of the aspects or angles in the measurement of blood pressure. What other errors are possible? Well, the cuff size. Small cuff, for example, you know, AHA, the American Heart Association, gives certain dimensions for the cuff. What should be the dimensions of the cuff? The cuff should completely encircle the limb, the arm, or diameter of the cuff should be 20% wider, at least 20%, or 20 to 40% wider than the limb diameter. It should completely encircle the arm. These dimensions, these specifications have been given, at least 20% wider, but 20 to 40% ideal. Now, imagine an obese person with a very large limb and the cuff is small. What will happen? What is the possible error with a smaller cuff? Small cuff gives you erroneously high blood pressure. Why? Because small cuff tends to occlude the brachial artery incompletely. Because it's a small cuff, it tends to occlude the brachial artery incompletely. And what is the basis for our method for Rivaroki cuff? It should occlude the artery completely. So in order to occlude the brachial artery completely, you need to raise the pressure further. And that is why small cuff tends to give you a higher pressure than what is actually present. So these are some of the aspects that should always be kept in mind while recording the blood pressure. Particularly, I may re-emphasize again that when I mentioned higher pressure as compared to intravascular pressure, it's not an error, because all our blood pressure data and all our labeling of hypertension or hypotension is from the Rivaroki cuff and sphygmomanometry only. So it's not as if it is erroneously higher, we are saying. It's just that comparatively intravascular pressure, the Rivaroki cuff gives you generally the higher pressure. So that's some of the angles of blood pressure measurement by sphygmomanometer.